all of you. Thank you for being here, and thank you to Manishji, thank you to Abid Ali for inviting me again to this forum. It's always great to be here because you get to meet a lot of people who are thinking on similar lines, and there's so much of cross exchange that happens. So I'm hoping that I can throw light on a very different spectrum of how my life changed. So I'm basically going to be sharing a story with you. It's not any jargon that I know, or you know, anything that that is going to be very profound in terms of knowledge. All I'm going to do is share my story and how my life has changed because of the miracle of purpose. So there was a time which I was experiencing this. Have you guys ever experienced something like a burnout?
Yeah.
Oh, great. So I have company. That's a good thing. So this was about 2012. We had gone through a big expansion in our company, about 3x. You know, our bankers laughed at us when we went with the proposal, went with the proposal to them as well. But then, you know, as big, hairy, audacious goals go, that, you know, things conspired, and yes, we were able to do it, but we did it really badly. So we were in big financial trouble. We had to go into corporate debt restructuring. We thankfully came out of it. But that happened. Then there is a lot of attrition that was happening in the company because people were not seeing that, you know, we are going anywhere. There was this uncertainty that was going through my life. I'd also just started going through a divorce, which wasn't such a happy thing, and there were kids involved, so you know, all sorts of mess. So there was complete a feeling of burnout, and why, what am I really doing? Which basically, if I look at the result of that burnout, I basically started questioning, why am I here? You know, am I really doing what I should be doing? And I started looking for even for buyers for the company. I thought, you know, maybe this is not what I should be doing. Maybe I should sell this off and go to the Himalayas and maybe meditate or take a sabbatical, as they say, and find my real calling in life and, you know, do something like that. And why did that happen? So the background of that is that, as Manishji said, I inherited the company from my father in 1999, and I inherited it because not because of a desire to inherit it, but because my father wanted to spend the rest of his life on his motorcycle. So, and he couldn't sell off the company, and he had two sons. One was in sports, which was me, and the other was in hospitality. I was the one who had actually worked, spent time in the company and knew how it works. And I saw that whole struggle with my father of wanting to let go of something, not being able to let go. I said, okay, if somebody has to dispose it, even let me come in, and then, you know, we'll see what happens. So, but as things go, I came in and got totally sucked in. There was a lot of union troubles back then and a lot of drama. I'm from East UP, so, you know, you hear of a lot of drama there. It's not actually as bad as they make it out to be. But there was a lot of commotion that happened. And as a young 24-year-old, you get to see a very different side of life. But again, as a young 24-year-old or 26-year-old, you have these big goals. And again, it was about growth. And it kept me going. But what I realized also was, what I also realized was that, this is something that I'm pushing myself to. And I'm sure you guys may have gone through something like that. You know, when you have to wake yourself up and motivate yourself, ki haan nahi, aaj bhi jana hai, aaj bhi karna hai, yes, this is really important and it's got to be done. And, that's how life was functioning. Also, what was happening was I had a very illustrious father. And I don't know, again, a lot of you are daughters and sons of wonderful fathers, I'm sure. And I don't know how many of you want to be like your father. I'm sure subconsciously to hota hoga, because I always wanted to be like my father. And everything was about, you know, doing things his way. And he was very operations driven, very hands-on. He never wanted me to be like him. But there was this aspiration, and I was always trying to be somebody else. However, as things go, around that time, I also met a wonderful person who is now my wife, and she asked a very critical question to me. She said, okay, if everything was taken off, don't worry about money, don't worry about time, what would you really do? What would that question be? And I would really request all of you to question yourself at some point about that, because I think that changed my life a lot. And when I thought about it, I thought it's going to be something to do with nature for me. You know, I would do something which would enable me to spend more time with nature, do something which would leave the earth better, do something which would be more geology and geography and you know, that sort of domain of work. Around the same time, I also met an amazing person. I don't know if any of you know him. Do you know? Oh, great. Have you attended his course?
Yeah. He's
oh, wonderful. Yeah, ISB. So Dr. Prasad Kaipa is a wonderful person. Those who haven't attended his course, for strategy leaders, I would highly recommend it. It's called Transformational Leadership, and he does that about two or three times a year at ISB. It's an amazing life transforming course, so you would know what I'm talking about. But he taught me a couple of things. Number one thing he taught me, nothing in life is a coincidence. अभी तक तो मैंने ये मान रखा था कि कोइंसिडेंस की वजह से आई थिंक देयर सम नॉन हिंदी स्पीकर्स सो आई स्विच सो आई हैड अज्यूम्ड बाय नाउ दैट बिकॉज ऑफ कोइंसिडेंस आई एंटर्ड दिस बिजनेस एंड यू नो आई जस्ट हैपेंड टू बी देयर एंड आई हैड दिस फैमिली व्हिच आई हैड टू सॉर्ट ऑफ हेल्प बट ही सेड देयर आर नो सच थिंग्स यू एंड आई आर हियर फॉर अ सर्टेन रीजन एट अ सर्टेन टाइम यू नो द सिंक्रोनिसिटी ऑफ द यूनिवर्स इज जस्ट अमेजिंग व्हेन यू स्टार्ट लुकिंग एट इट एंड ही आल्सो सेड दैट यू नो व्हाटएवर यू हैव लर्नड सो फार You cannot wish it away. You cannot go on the sabbatical journey and you can't go to the Himalayas. You can, of course, but you know, maybe you won't return with anything very different. So, you know, you can go on this journey, but the point is that you've gathered a lot of knowledge by now. You've gathered this, you've made whatever you are, you've already created that part, and it's better to build on top of that. You can take that knowledge and drive it somewhere else, but don't wish it away. And the third and the most important thing, which is what I'm talking about and what really transformed my life, he said that once your purpose is never about yourself, your purpose is only about what you contribute to the lives of others. And can you make it, you know, multiple X's? You know, if you think that you can do this much for this many people, can you make it a million X? You know, can you contribute? Can you think in that scale? And that is what truly changed the way we ran our business. So what I had inherited was a typical pulp and paper company making packaging paper. And what we started doing on reflection was, we started thinking, how are we going to replace flexible packaging? You know, when I thought about my whole idea of being with nature, and I realized that, okay, I'm going to take a step back again. So the reflection part was that when I looked at our own business, there was a lot of things that we were doing that could actually align with my core feeling of being with nature. We were in the packaging paper business. Most of our paper was being used, and most of you thankfully use it every day. Most of the soaps in this country are wrapped in our paper. So those of you who do take a bath and still are with soaps rather than shower gels, you know, thank you to you. Some of you may go to that amazingly wonderful company called McDonald's. All their paper, all their bags are ours. Some of you may go to the cafe coffee days of the world and use sugar sachets. And I hope drink a lot of sugar with your coffee, because those sachets are on VRs. So, you know, and things like that, Band-Aid covers many times, surgical gloves, they're very specialized sort of applications which you maybe not think about. But what you would also realize across these applications is that many of them are PE lined. They get lined by plastic. So if I have a soap manufacturer, they want a, you know, a top layer of plastic and an under layer of plastic, and my paper is only a carrier for that plastic. So again, it becomes as bad for the earth as, you know, a plastic would be. My paper doesn't count for much, even though it's biodegradable and compostable and what have you. So we realized that we were in this business where we could be contributing a lot in terms of better packaging, but we are not. We also realized that there is a lot of potential that could be created by getting into a non-commoditized sector. So, you know, typically whatever we made, it could be very high-tech paper for surgical gloves, for example, but it gets commoditized really fast. Because in the end, there'll be some alternative which is already available, or it'll be made available very quickly. So we have to go into a little bit of value addition. So those were the two things that started driving our journey. And the plan became that, one, we are going to find alternates to flexible packaging. For those of you who don't understand the term, it's things like potato chip bags, highly engineered. They don't go away for at least 100,000 years. You know, plastic starts disintegrating in 500 years. The normal plastic starts disintegrating in 500 years. Do you know how many years plastic has been around? Yes. Yeah, 70 exactly. So 70 years. So the first plastic will start disintegrating in 430 years. So, you know, so not even the first plastic that was created is going to disintegrate. So we're creating a huge damage and we don't realize it. And flexible packaging is so engineered to ensure that our products inside it remain fresh. And hence they've created it so that it's so multi-layered and it ends up being there for, they say 100,000 years. Who really knows what 100,000 years is? It cannot be recycled as well. The second area of our work became styrofoam. You guys know that thing?
Yeah.
The white thing. Do not eat from it. It's highly carcinogenic. So people in India, we even put hot food in it. Even you get it in like malls and airports and stuff like that, and I'm amazed because it's highly carcinogenic. And you're not supposed to put hot food and, you know, consume from it because it leaches into the hot food. And we use it abundantly. Again, non-recyclable, non-compostable. So we said, okay, what can we do about that? We started working a lot with, you know, in very, very interesting areas. And the next photograph will tell you more about that area. But it was fundamentally to do with how do we learn from nature. And this was a product that we worked with an American company. And this is made out of mushrooms, mushroom extract, mycelium, for those who know mycelium. It's an amazing product and we grew it. How do you grow a product to replace styrofoam, which goes into protection of like white goods like TVs, fridges, those big blocks of thermopol, as we call it. And the most amazing work that we do today is to realize that the best packaging is done by nature. You know, you can look around you and everything is packaged so amazingly well. You can always tell from outside what's inside. You know that it's going to go back and become something else or go back into the earth. You know its purpose very clearly. It protects, you know, those thin pomegranate seeds inside that amazing, you know, creation of beauty from the universe. You know, those bananas that can be just thrown green into a truck and taken 1,000 miles and, you know, then ripened there. You know, nothing, no need to sort of package it in a box. Our own skins, nothing comes out, nothing goes in and it still breathes. It's amazing to see that, you know, and you can just see it across. And everything has an end of life. Everything has an end of life cycle. It goes into something else. So we've been doing a lot of learning, and now we are setting up this whole research center based on biomimicry, as it's called. The whole science is called biomimicry. And what came out of it is also a product which I proudly wear the name of. It's called Chuck. I'm just going to play you a 2-minute video, and that should give me adequate time to end.
Every day, we use and toss almost 1 million tons of plastic and styrofoam. This stuff is piling up. These products actually harm our own health and habitat. So why do we love them so much? Let me introduce you to Chuck. Why would you fall in love with Chuck? Chuck is made from the pulp of local sugarcane waste. We mold the pulp into amazingly well-designed modular single-use tableware. Chuck is natural ground to avoid harmful bleaching. We test every batch for water and oil resistance. Our products are ovenable, microwavable and freezable. Plus, you put Chuck in the ground and in a couple months it becomes manure. Even our packaging is compostable. Chuck is crafted in a completely hygienic modern facility with 100% biomass electricity and 95% of our cooking chemical recovered. We also choose to employ local, and women make up to 50% of our team. Sounds too good to be true? It's not. We choose to be economical, so price is a barrier to no one. Chuck is safe for the family, it's safe for the planet, great for business, and definitely makes the calf smile. We're going to be producing 1 million in a day now, and 4 million in 3 years. Together, we can make a dent in that pile. Together, we can change the world.
So this was just, this just came out because of that one idea. That, you know, we want to do something bigger than what we are doing. We don't want to just run a wonderful business, well, make a lot of money, you know, create wealth for shareholders. Those things are needed. It's a performance thing. You have to perform. But fundamentally, the business has to count for more. And the result of this is that, you know, we wake up bright and shiny every day. We look forward to the work that we do. You know, there's a huge contribution. Well, our share price also went up 10x. And nothing to do. We're not working any harder or any smarter, for that matter. The only thing that changed was this idea of finding what's your North Star, what's your purpose, what's the meaning, what how can you contribute to your life? So my purpose here is to basically encourage all of you to think about that purpose, because that changes life altogether. Thank you so much.